But also from Right to Water and now the Right to Change campaign, which people can ask questions on later on as well if they want. So I'll get through it as quickly as possible. Water and TTIP, there's not really too much you can say actually. I'll just read out from the Right to Water Boiling Water Report, which I think is the best name for a report that's ever come out, the Boiling Water Report. Because Lynn Boylan, the MEP, drafted it, so it's named after the person who drafts it, which is just very relevant. So that report that came out a couple of months ago and was adopted by the European Parliament, it urges the Commission to grant a legally binding exclusion for water services, sanitation services and wastewater disposal services in the ongoing negotiations for the TTIP and the Trade and Services Agreement. So, very strong urging of the EU Parliament towards the Commission and the negotiators of the agreement. It also recalls the significant number of petitions opposing the inclusion of essential public services such as water and sanitation in the negotiations for TTIP, and calls for on the Commission to increase the accountability of water supply. So that's it, lads. That's the end of the presentation. It's out of TTIP because we all know how democratic the EU is, and they'll just take everything that the Parliament says on board, and we don't have to worry about anything, of course. But that's not the case. And in water services, it's actually one of the interesting sections of the negotiations because, unlike most of the other industry areas being negotiated, all the pressure from corporations is coming from the European side for water to be opened up. Because four out of the top five water companies in the world are from Europe. They're Veolia, Suez, United Utilities and Severn Trent. Only one out of the top five come from the United States. So it shows you that the pressure that's coming is actually coming from our side of the Atlantic at this moment in time. And you just look at the negotiators and who they've been talking to, you can see 4% of the discussions have taken place with the lobbyists have been public interest, but 92% is coming from the private sector lobby. So these guys, Veolia, Suez and all those lads, they're having all the say, and nobody in Europe has actually asked to meet with any of us, which is strange. As you can see again, another fact of the top 25 lobby contacts are all industry again. So we know what the agenda is for the lobbying interest, but we know who's having a say towards the negotiators. And we also know what the Commission's line is when it comes to water services. The Commission believes that the privatisation of public utilities, including water supply firms, can deliver benefits to the society when carefully made. I'm not sure they really give a shit about carefully made, that's their line. That's been the line for a long time. It's not the only quote in terms of that the Commission have come out with in terms of water supply, and they're lining it up. And it's not as direct, and they're not going to do it direct because, as people are probably aware, the first petition that reached the what's the European Citizens Initiative was actually around water. So it's no matter what country you're in, water is something that the public care about and ownership of it and everything else. So they'll take their time, and I'll go through how they got to where we are and how we got to where we are as a result of the rules that they put in place, because the rules are there in order to bring us to a situation where you have to privatise in the future. And you have to look back to the fiscal compact and when that came in and put in rules for governments about debt GDP ratios and everything else, right? So you have to reach 3% debt GDP ratio, but when you have that in place, it puts a panic on the government in order to get things off balance sheet. They have to get things off balance sheet. And in order to get your water services, which is one of the big expenditures that our government or any government would have, off balance sheet, 50% of the costs plus one must come from water charges, commercial and domestic. So that means 1.2 billion currently, which is an underspend at the moment, 1.2 billion every year is spent on water services in Ireland. But obviously, investment is badly needed. We've boiling water notices going all over, and there's subventions coming into the Irish water from the general taxation funds in order to try and plug that gap temporarily. But it means at least 601 million is needed from water charges alone. And it's interesting, I was doing my research for this part, that this next slide is probably not as relevant to the TTIP stuff, but it's really interesting about who actually launched the very first non-payment campaign in Ireland. But it gives you an idea of the mentality behind the people who are trying to bring in water charges. Commercial companies are refusing to pay. 37% of all commercial companies in Dublin are refusing to pay their water rates, their water charges, right? So we're going to have to plug the gap. But collected in Dublin in 2013 is 26,650 €1,000 uncollected in Dublin, 16 million, 502,000 out of Dublin alone, never mind the rest of the country. The rest of the country don't actually give you the figures, so we don't know how much is not being paid. The expected income, and everyone on the left is arguing over who started the non-payment campaign and who's had it. The companies did. They started the non-payment campaign a long time ago. And one of the statistics from this as well is that 50 million of it was just written off last year. And then 100 million of it has been passed on to Irish Water for Irish Water to collect because nobody's collecting it. So there's 150 million that's outstanding in terms of bills paid. That is, you know, controversial, but they're not sure whether they're going to collect it or not. But the expected income in 2015 from water charges, both commercial and domestic. Commercial is 229 million and domestic is 270 million. Bringing the total to 500 million, which still doesn't add up to the 601 million that's currently needed. So they cut services recently in the past few years, so that's probably why it's slightly lower. But it's funny, we're expected to pay 60% of the costs. Who uses all the water in Ireland? It's not households. 10% of water usage is households. So they're expected, this is about a transfer of the responsibility for paying for water services from the people who use it, the corporations, to all of us. Intel, are the biggest user of water in Ireland. You can look at Guinness is using water. You can look at Ballygown, who don't pay a penny to extract any amount of water they want from the ground. All of these companies are using it, and they put it in a bottle, and they make 90 billion in profits last year alone from a company called Britvic, who also own Club Orange and the rest. And so they use our water in order to make all these products, make 90 million from it, don't pay a penny, and there's no limits, which is a breach of the EU regulations on water, by the way, because there is no accountability on it. They don't even tell you how much they're taking out of the ground. They don't tell the government because the government haven't put in any restrictions around that. And Alan Farrell said it, and it's the first time I've heard an honest Fine Gael TD talking about water. He said on Clare Byrne a couple of weeks ago when RTE decided that they would have a balanced debate about water charges. About, on one hand, we'll have Alan Farrell from Fine Gael on the government side arguing about water charges. And on the flip side, we'll have Eddie Hobbs arguing for water charges as well. So we'll have an honest debate about which type of water charges we should bring in instead of having somebody who's anti-water charges. But he said on the show, and nobody's picked up on it, and I'm amazed that nobody's picked up on it, he said in order to incentivise more corporations coming into Ireland, we need people to pay for water because they don't want to pay for it. Now this is the agenda of Fine Gael. This is the whole point of bringing in water charges, is to shift the responsibility from the corporations to everybody else. In the same way they have in terms of the taxes, the revenue that we bring in, the labour, everything is in favour because we want to be the best small country in the world to do business. And that's the agenda behind it. So we've heard, and people in this room probably, and others outside, still think it's about conservation. And this is one of the lines that you come across. We want an adequate supply of treated water to meet each household's normal domestic needs while preserving the incentive for conservation. It's a nonsense argument because it doesn't work. And I'll tell you why it doesn't work now in a second. Because the rules start off as a revenue-raising mechanism, not a conservation mechanism, right? The rules are, as I said, 51% must come from charges, right? So you initially start off with we have to raise 600 million, right? UN resolution says 36,500 litres are needed per person in order to survive, to live. That's what's needed to drink and to cook and to wash yourself, right? Irish Water says we use an average of 54,750 litres per year, which strangely is 20% less than they use in the UK where there are charges. But they tell us the charges will tell people to conserve, right? So how are we using less than the UK currently? When, and not only a tiny bit less, but we're as you can see, we're using about 14,000 litres per year less than they use in the UK, and we don't have the charges in place. That's Irish Water statistic, and then the British Water Systems as well. But it means that 19,250 litres on average per person must raise 350 million, as a minimum. And that minimum is because we're shifting the burden to taxpayers rather than corporations. So that can happen again, where at the moment they're expecting us to pay a proportion of that, 60% of that responsibility. Do you think they're not going to increase that to 100% over time and the corporations won't have to pay any? I don't know, maybe, but also if they don't increase the investment, it's going to have to be more than 350 million. So as a minimum, 350 million must come from 19,250 litres. So if everybody reduces their usage to the bare minimum just to get by, they still have to raise that 350 million. right? Which means that if every household in Ireland just used 36,501 litres, it would cost you €184 for that extra litre. Right? That's the way the system is set up. That's the rules as they stand. However, if one household only went over and all the others abided by the 36,500 litres, it means that one household owes the government 350 million. That's how ridiculous the rules are. That's the rules that they put in place and said to us, the Commission have met us and said, this is about conservation. And it's not. It's the real issue. Or the real agenda behind it is this. The Economist, a real front page of The Economist magazine, which is the business lobby's magazine, I suppose, and they say the $9 trillion sale, we're coming for almost everything must go, and they're coming for everything. So you can say oil, gas, and mineral rights, and that's what it is. It's privatisation agenda. It's set up in a way that you have to privatise in the future, and it's the great transfer of wealth. It's from both the government and the EU, and if people don't believe that, ask the government why they haven't given us a referendum to enshrine ownership in our hands, because that way they couldn't privatise in the future, and that's why they're afraid. They could make themselves popular literally overnight by giving a referendum to make sure that it's not privatised in the future. But the long-term game is to privatise. And the only reason it wasn't privatised when we had our bailout in 2010 was because we didn't have a profit-making revenue stream in place. We didn't have the metering system in place. We'll get back to the metering system in a second, but Portugal and Greece just happened to have a metering system in place, so they were forced to privatise. So this, I said it was a slow game at the start of this. It's a very slow game when it comes to Ireland. Let's meter the place first, and next time they need a bailout, let's privatise it. That's the agenda behind it. And if you don't believe me, go to www.watermeetsmoney.com for an honest assessment from the actual corporations themselves who hold conference every year to talk to each other about what's the best way to raise revenue and make profits and make money out of water at the expense of all of us. And that's a screenshot that Gareth got me last night, because for some reason my phone and my laptop is blocked from the website. I don't know why, but I can't get into it anymore. I used to be able to look at it, and somehow they've managed to block me. But why? And this is it. This is the key reason that people need to be aware of. This is the UK. I'm going to go through the next four slides about the UK, and I'm talking very fast, so sorry about that, but we're running out of time. Water, in terms of corporations, or as in terms of an industry, is a highly profitable one, because we all need water to survive. If you don't have water, you die. If you don't have water, you can't clean yourself. If you can't have sanitation services. So water is a valuable, valuable, valuable commodity. There's very few other things that are as valuable as it. And if you look at the list there, operating profit on the top of just over 30%, almost consistent the whole way along. I know Aidan was mentioning the profit levels from the education sector, but this is 30% at this moment in time in terms of operating profits. And then even when you take out the taxes and everything else, it says pre-tax profit is, where is it? Post-tax profit is pre-tax profit, less tax. Retained profit is what is left over after dividends have been paid, right? So here's your after dividends have been paid. And that's the profit levels at the top. So everything in between has been paid out to shareholders, right? So that's why people are after our water services all over the world. And not just ours. I mean, this is spreading everywhere. Water compared with other private sector companies, you might think, you know, well, that's probably, you know, similar to education or anything else. But let's look at it, right? This is water. This is other commercial services. These are the operating surplus, the profit levels, compared. Water, anything else? Dividends. Double what you get. So water provides double the dividend that any other industry will provide for you. So that's why another reason why they're after it. And who pays the price? We do. This line here is the retail prices index in the UK since 1990 going up. Well, everything else has gone up in terms of prices. This is how their water has gone up from a flat level. So there you go. You can see who pays it in the end, because we have no option but to pay for water if they bring in the water, so metering. So who's after it? This is the chart of who used to own water services in the UK. I'm just going to move along quickly, but you can see private equity consortiums decided in 2002. Shit, there's a lot of fucking money to be made out of this. Let's start buying in. And this is now who owns. Private equity consortiums now own more than half of the water services in the UK. And bear in mind, the only one that's left as a non-profit is Welsh Water. Welsh Water is still a cooperative owned by the people of Wales. It's still, you have to pay water charges, but it's owned by the people. How long they can hold out as a cooperative, we don't know. But the Welsh Water guy, this is interesting, Welsh Water guy went on Irish Radio about a year, year and a half ago, saying, with a really interesting statement. He said, for Welsh water, it costs nothing to purify, nothing different to purify 1,000 litres of water or 100,000 litres of water. It's all just the same amount of chemicals, you throw them in. It's not, it's, this isn't about conservation. He went to Welsh Water chief executive saying this to people. Again, it wasn't reported afterwards. It was a silence in the media and from everybody else about that. So let's look at the outcome in terms of the UK. In 2013, in Britain, private water companies made profits of 2.81 billion, paid a dividend of 2.55 billion to shareholders while paying only 101 million in taxes. So, seven water companies paid no corporation tax at all, and a report has shown that they're not helping people with their sky-high bills. And the investments in big infrastructure profits, projects are being used to write off their taxes. They say we're going to invest in, you know, massive project over there, and they write down their taxes based on that. And that's how they make enough to give the dividend of 2.55 billion. And you think about that, same sort of system is happening in the US. People probably know about Detroit and the water shutoffs and everything that's going on over there, but 46% of everything that they pay in Detroit for their water services actually goes to the financial services sector, because they brought in bonds. It's still a public-owned utility, but they brought in a bond system. So you bring in Ireland, they're trying to bring in a bond system. The Irish Water have said they want to bring in a 10 billion euro bond that will yield a 5.1%. So on a good day, that could raise 510 million for the owners of that bond over a period of time whenever it's cashed in. Right? So that's the agenda behind it. Even if it is public owned, you bring in a bond system, and a proportion of whatever you pay towards water then goes to owners of financial products, right? So that's why they wanted the financial services side of it. And then in Britain, as you saw, 20 to 30% of everything you pay in your bills goes towards a payout to as dividends to shareholders. So people saying that bringing in these charges is about conservation, to me, is a bit nonsense, because 30% profit should be spent on upgrading the infrastructure, paying to fix the leaks, educating people across the country about why conservation is badly needed, and any other things, like bringing in legislation to prevent or so that any new buildings have conservation measures enshrined in them, that they have to have water-saving devices. Water butts collecting rainwater, then that's used for flushing the water. But that has never come in, because that was never the real agenda. They never tried to bring in anything that was conservation except for water charges, and you can see why there. So just very quickly about where we are now, that's the agenda, why both Europe and why Ireland and the Irish government are trying to bring it in. The Boiling Water Report, when it came out, calls obviously for the exclusion of water from TTIP, but there's fears that they'll come after sanitation as one end of it, as a means to get it in anyway. But to be honest, like, the Commission who are negotiating it are not accountable to the Parliament, they're more accountable to the Council, so, which is the heads of states, so they don't really give a shit what the Parliament says. It will be presented as a fait accompli. You risk jobs if you try to get out this small bit at the end. So they'll just present a report and say, look, it's all in there, sorry about that. You know, there's a few things, but look, if you don't adopt this right now with everything in it, we can't make amendments. This is a long process. We've been doing this since 2012 or 13 or whenever they started. So it's just going to have to fly. And a US politician's actually seen saw the TPP negotiations. This is about a year ago, said this: if the American public could see what is being negotiated, there would be riots on the street. And I think that something very similar is going to be with TTIP. If people knew what was being negotiated behind closed doors, they wouldn't stand for it. And what is being done is being set up as a kind of fait accompli, whereby it would be too late to do anything when the whole thing is finished. It will be presented to the public and said, we are sorry, we can't actually change it, you just have to accept it. And that's what's happening with TTIP as well. They will have water services in it. Since the Boiling Water Report came out, a week later, the EU, European Parliament Research Service report, produced a new document, a new piece of evidence, because they're renegotiating now the EU Water Services Directive. It's about to kick off again, right? So this new piece of evidence that will be used in the information for the people who are redesigning the Water Directive says that we need increased pricing as a means of reducing usage, and current policies, and this is a quote from the report, it was drafted by an Irish guy actually, current policies on water pricing should be complemented with rules on the mandatory use of water meters by end users. So that's going to be the advice for the new water directive as they're developing that. So just to cut it off short a little bit, because I know I'm talking pretty quickly, but there's two major dangers. There's a privatisation, as people have heard earlier on today. It will open up the market. That's the intention of it. It will stop the regulatory barriers, things that is, you know, preventing Veolia from coming in here and taking over. the system. It's a highly sought after industry. They call it the blue gold, because you can't live without it. Threat to investment, profits, dividends, taxes. The ISDS makes it impossible to take it back, or very difficult, prohibitive to take it back. In Berlin earlier this year, I think it was March, they kicked Veolia out, who had a contract until 2028. But breaking that contract has just cost them 650 million, even though they now have to pay for their own water system. Veolia can walk away, but they walk away with 650 million of lost profits that they could have had between now and 2028. That's without an ISDS. So bringing an ISDS, and it might even be worse. That was something that the Berlin people negotiated, Berlin government negotiated. And that's the agenda, tapping into your resources, trying to make fat cats even fatter. And just very briefly, I'm going to touch on the right to change thing, because people might not know. I'm not going to get into all the details, but right to change, we've been touring the country talking to people about stuff like this. TTIP has brought up that some of we were in Sligo, Letterkenny, we've done Tralee, Limerick, Dundalk, and a couple of Dublins, and we've just announced this morning the next set of just 23 more that we've announced this morning, where we talk about this, the water, but we go beyond that to right to sustainable environment, right to debt relief, right to natural resources, equality, education, housing, jobs. It's all the same agenda, whether we're talking about water or anything else. The agenda is to turn everything in Ireland and across Europe into a commodity that can be bought and sold, and people, it doesn't matter about human rights anymore. And that's what we're trying to raise awareness of. And what we'll be doing is trying to raise, through those meetings, we'll be trying to raise awareness around TTIP and what's included, what's the agenda behind it, and so that every single one of these people who comes out on our marches, on the Right to Water marches, has mobilised across this country. That was the first one, that was the second one, and that was the local ones, that was Swords. It just happened to be my local town where 5,000 people came out. Never had a protest there ever before, and 5,000 people come onto the streets out of 40,000, population 40,000. December 10th, March 21st, August 29th, the most recent one. And what we're hoping to do is open people, everyone there will understand what TTIP is about and the agenda behind it. And that's the challenge we have.